Well, Murray, explain to us what you're outraged by.
So overnight, the report came out. It was in New Zealand Herald who broke the story. We've known about this kind of World League for a while now. World Rugby have proposed this tournament, essentially a 12-team competition every year that involves the Six Nations plus the Rugby Championship teams, and the other nations were kind of as yet undecided. There was a proposal that there would be relegation, promotion, and involvement for the kind of tier two, to give them that tag, those nations. But essentially now the picture has changed quite quickly. They're talking about a 12-team World League involving the Six Nations, the Rugby Championship teams, plus USA and Japan, with no relegation, no promotion. So essentially you're locking out the Pacific Island nations from involvement. It will be more lucrative, which is the key point here. You're talking about an extra maybe 6 to 8 million euro per union per season from TV revenue, which is a big number. And I think World Rugby would probably argue that they would put that some of that money back into the Pacific Island nations and developing them there.
For me, there's two issues here. And I'm not really overly concerned with Owen Farrell's one around the club constraints. I mean, I think if you just look at it from an international point of view, I do think player welfare, you know, international rugby is another step up again, and to increase the load on players is dangerous in a time when we're trying to, you know, manage their injuries and look after them. And then the other thing is, you know, the Pacific Island nations, I think it would be absolutely detrimental to them. They don't get a fair crack at a whip in terms of preparation time, in terms of facilities, in terms of budgets, etc. But they are a huge part of world rugby, and we're all, you know, we all benefit from seeing their ability. You know, we Mata, the Edinburgh number eight, you know, he's a joy to watch. He brightens up our weekends, you know, and he's just one of hundreds of talented Pacific Island Nation players who play in Europe domestically, or when we see them play for Tonga, Fiji, Samoa, etc. At World Cups or November series. So I think they're the ones who, you know, we need to fight for this, to stop this, to protect them to a certain extent, because their voice isn't always heard.
Well, here to give it to give their voice some airtime, or one of them at least, the Samoa captain Chris Vui also spoke within that statement that was released by the IRPC, and he said, "For countries in this bracket, and for Pacific Islanders in particular, our biggest issue has always been the club versus country factor. We feel that a 12-year deal is not workable, particularly when it presents no hope of advancement during that period. This will have the dangerous knock-on effect of luring senior players away from their countries and more towards the clubs, which is the exact opposite of what we're all trying to achieve."
Just on that, I mean, Chris Vui's plays for Bristol, and Bristol have a lot of Samoan players, but part of the attraction of going to Bristol is, you know, Pat Lam as a, you know, as a Samoan is not going to, I suppose, is not going to discourage you to go play for your country. You know, there's no coincidence that players like to go there because they know he's going to be favourable to them. But there's been examples in France and other clubs where players are discouraged from traveling in November, or, you know, or going back in June to play, and they're caught in a very tricky situation because they've got mortgages, bills to pay. Some of them are supporting extended families back in the islands, and clubs aren't always as fair and showing the integrity they should to allow those players play for club and country.
So you're just going to get a situation where essentially what we're saying is really good international players from Fiji, Tonga, Samoa retiring from international rugby because their club is going to pay them really well for that, and they're not going to want to travel back for what are going to be tier two tests for the next 10 years. So there's no incentive for them to continue to play. Obviously, there's national pride, but on a professional basis, their clubs are going to have an even stronger hand to play by saying, listen, stay here, retire from international rugby, which would just be a travesty. As Bernard says, so many of the best players in rugby come from that region. It's not just them either. Like, you look at the world rugby rankings, and Georgia are number 12 at the moment. They won't be involved.
They won't be in it, but Italy are 15 and will be.
Fiji are ninth in France.
Yeah.
But they won't be involved. Fiji
won't. Yeah, exactly.
Fiji won't be
they won't
involved.
Be involved either. So they're actually in the top 10 nations.
Even look below that, say, tier again, and say Brazil are doing great things, and like rugby seems to have built up a bit of a head of steam down there. Canada won't be involved, as far as I'm aware.
Depends on GDP. Doesn't matter about where they're at. It's financially the countries that can bring the most to the party. Rather than actually the rugby quality, that's a killer. So Fiji have made strides, ninth in the world, but yes, and they're incredibly incredibly talented, incredibly exciting to watch. rugby gives them a way out of Fiji and changes, you know, their families' lives. Plus, they get they're incredibly proud to play for a country, whether it's in sevens or at 15s level. But they won't be in because they don't bring enough enough book to the World Rugby's coffers.
Yeah, and all rugby has done really with the islands is just take from them. There's nothing given back. Like the organization is called World Rugby, but essentially this arose and makes it what traditional nations rugby. It should be the title of the organization because there's no care for the wider world.